have come to visit you in peace and with goodwill.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to a new episode of Earth vs. Soup. I'm Aaron Pollyea.
I'm Darlene.
And today we're talking about a pretty awful film.
Yeah, and it fits the 13th.
Yeah, so we're the 13th episode, that's what we're on, and we're going to talk about Rocket Attack USA. And this barely fits into our criteria, but I thought it would be worth watching. And our criteria is that it's 50s or 60s. It's a 50s or 60s movie.
Yes, it is.
It has science fiction-ish elements or yes, fantasy. It could be fantasy. And this definitely does fit into
science fiction.
I would say it fits more into fantasy because it's...
Well, Aaron, it was supposed to be science fiction.
It's more science fiction. It's supposed to be
science fiction. But it acts like a documentary style because you have this narrator. And thank goodness you have the narrator.
Otherwise, you wouldn't understand anything.
You wouldn't have a clue. So please tell me the premise.
Okay,
it doesn't have
a
plot.
We should also say that this was done on Mystery Science Theater 3000. But I'm glad that I watched it without MST3K for this episode here. Because MST3K, because it's funny and because you're laughing along with, you know, the robots and Joel, you can pass over a lot of the problems and things that this movie does right. Because believe it or not, I'm going to rip into this movie hard.
Well, like
I
said,
still does things
I already
right.
said, there is no plot.
There is no plot.
It's a premise.
It's a premise. So I'll talk about this now. Okay, so because it's my turn to deal with the plot, and I actually have to try to reason out what the plot is. The basic idea of this film is that the Soviets have put Sputnik up into
orbit.
In
1957.
Yeah. And because they put a satellite in orbit, they're now able to properly figure out how to build rockets. Even though it took a rocket to get Sputnik into a stable orbit, because Sputnik is now in orbit gathering data, they're able to build a proper rocket. Okay. So right away, first scene, complete nonsense.
Well, it was doing two transmission types.
Yeah, it was like gathering data about something.
I didn't understand that either.
So the U.S. is now very concerned that the Soviets have one-upped the United States, which they did in real life, by putting the first satellite in orbit, putting the first, you know, human being in orbit, putting the first woman in orbit. The Soviets, for most of the space race, let's be honest,
won it.
Except for the moon. But, I mean, I guess that was kind of the go-home point of the space race, if you got to the moon first. Anyway, so the CIA decides that they need to send a spy over to Moscow to figure out...
Oh, that's after the boring conversation.
We're ignoring boring conversations that have no point.
The general, the German scientist, and I put that in quotes
because he was
really bad at acting.
Okay, Darlene, all the acting in this movie is bad.
Well, he didn't do a German accent worth a damn.
Let's keep with the plot. Well, and we use plot very loosely here.
Premise.
Okay. So the CIA sends, George White. And.
Oh, no, that was John. Sorry,
he goes to Moscow.
He goes to Moscow.
And it's the only way you know it's Moscow is that you're told it's Moscow and you're shown some stock footage of Moscow very early on in the movie, but nothing about it says Moscow. I'll talk about one good point in this movie later that actually occurs here. But he contacts like this woman from Germany, I guess.
Tanya, she's from Turkey.
Turkey. Okay, she fled to Germany and now is like working in Moscow as like a agent. And she has honey-trapped Minister of Defense.
Yes.
And if you don't know what honey-trapping is, folks, well...
Look it up.
Well, we should probably explain it. It's where you use sex to control somebody.
It's a spy that actually uses sex to control another agent or get information from a... They become a mistress of something. Or it could be a man.
It can be a male.
You really see that in that, because both those characters in that Russian spy thing.
Oh, and in the Americans? They cover that very clearly.
They
both were trained in how to do it. Now, here's the thing. The Soviets were noted honey trappers, that they generally liked doing it because it was an easy way to gain compromising material on people and to control them. And, you know, people, sex sells. So it does make sense why it's done. But anyway, she's a Western spy that's honey trapping.
But she was originally from Russia. Russia. She fled to Turkey.
And then to Germany?
I don't think she ever hit Germany.
That's what I got from this. Oh, okay. So maybe I'm wrong. Darlene's wrong. Anyway.
We're all wrong, probably.
The spy gets into Moscow. He ends up staying with her, which is like incredibly bad spycraft, because it puts her in danger.
Puts her in danger, puts him in danger.
It puts her intelligence operation against the Minister of Defense
The whole thing was very not spy-like, because he walks into that restaurant, cabaret, whatever the hell
He totally looks like a Western spy.
He looks totally Western. They both, the British spy and him, don't speak Russian.
They don't speak Russian, which, again, shocking. So they figure out that a rocket is being built outside of Leningrad. Okay, all right, fine.
I said Leningrad wouldn't have been a place.
And I said it doesn't matter because they built ICBM ports everywhere, so it doesn't really matter to me where they built it. I don't know why you think that was...
Because it's a swamp. That'd be like putting it right outside of New Orleans.
So you're saying all of Leningrad is swampy. If you walk out a door, there's no place that's hard and flat.
Okay, is New Orleans hard and flat in places?
There are many places that I can walk that are hard and flat because people built it that way. So having an ICBM launch site outside of Leningrad is not a big deal. Out of all the sins that this movie has... That is a very, very minor one. Let's put it that way. So they decide that they need to try to destroy this rocket. And so they drive up to Leningrad after the... They take a train up to Leningrad with the British spy after the woman...
Johnny does.
After the woman sleeps with the Minister of Defense again.
Till he gets drunk.
Till he gets drunk and he beats her. It's implied. Because her dress is all askew in weird ways. And anyway, they go up to Leningrad and...
Bad spycraft. You forgot that one.
Yeah. Well, no, I already talked about bad spycraft.
No, I'm talking about the fact that they fell in love.
Oh, yeah. Well, the two agents fell in love and it came out of nowhere. And it's really skeevy because the guy agent who's kind of living with the female agent... has to hide in the closet every time the Minister of Defense comes over. And he has to sit there and watch them.
Well, not watch. He listens.
He has to listen to them screwing over in the room, like literally outside the freaking closet door. Like, okay, guys, seriously, this movie's weird enough. And you're adding in this really strange, skeevy
love relationship.
I don't know.
Yeah.
Anyway, the British guy gets caught up there, and of course he can't speak Russian, so they know he's a goddamn Western spy.
Yep.
And
he gets caught by a Russian soldier with a U.S. helmet and a bar.
I don't know if it's a U.S. helmet. It looks like it's a very strange helmet. It looks different than the helmet that we have for World War II Soviet reenacting.
It doesn't look like our helmet.
But he definitely has a Browning automatic rifle. I mean, again, you could probably argue that there were some Browning automatic rifles in the Soviet Union from World War II, but let's be honest, this is 1961, and the Soviets already had access to AK-47s, and that was what was standard issue. I could see some of them having Mosin Nagant still. I can see some of them having SKS. Folks, we do World War II Soviet reenacting, so there are some things that we'll talk about after I get past this plot section that we actually complement them.
And we were in Russia not too long ago.
Well, I mean, it's been a while now, but I've been to Russia twice and you've been there once, and we've both been to Ukraine once. So anyway, back to this. They decide they're going to have like a satchel of explosives. There's a shootout with a few Russian soldiers, and Western spies get their butt shot off and they fail because of the bravery of one Soviet soldier
that runs with the bomb in his hands after an officer told him to go take this and run.
So this Soviet soldier sacrificed himself,
but the set, I'll talk about later.
So the Soviets decide that they're going to launch their single missile.
And both of those get shot by
Browning, right?
Well, she gets shot by something, and she tells Johnny to, Johnny, go on.
Just go, go, go on. Don't worry about me. And then she, like, blows a soldier away in the back.
In the back with a pistol, which I don't know what.
All right, so anyway, the plot is,
but he gets shot by a bar.
The Soviets decide to launch their missile. Yep. Their single missile. And they targeted at New York, and because this is sort of a propaganda piece, they've already said that the Soviet Air Force is undefeatable, that the Soviet Air Force will take out all of American 100% of American aircraft coming in to attack them. So they feel like they can just make this strike with a single nuclear weapon and win the war. So what happens? The nuke comes in. Everyone does nothing, seemingly enough. It seems like it. There's a few people that tend to go to
the general, like, sends out the Nikes.
Yeah, they launch like Nike anti-missile systems. The Nikes miss because America bad. Or at least because this movie's trying to make a point about being unprepared. And
is that what its point?
It has to be. Otherwise, it's the only other point that I can think of is that America is incredibly dumb. And the Soviets are worse because they didn't plan properly for an actual offensive war and launched a single weapon to piss everyone off against them. And it would have turned the whole... Anyway, the freaking nuke comes in. Freaking, I did not swear. The nuke comes in and detonates over New York City, killing 3 million people. We see a woman crying because her husband was a radio announcer that we met 10 minutes before. The end, question mark.
No, it says let's
not have this be the end or whatever.
Be the end, yeah.
So there really isn't a plot because this story could have been told in 10 minutes.
And stock footage.
So obviously we have a lot of venom in our hearts for this movie. So we should actually start by saying what was good in this movie, because we have to admit there is some neat and good things in it.
They use stock footage good.
The stock footage was actually really well done, and I have never seen a movie that has used stock footage of a military constellation, Lockheed Constellation, that was also an AWACS. It had like radar systems and everything on it. I've never seen that stock footage before. Which is crazy, and I love airplanes. I love the Constellation because it's such a unique plane. It has three tails. I've never seen that. Good use of stock footage. They use stock footage as a way to show, like,
the rockets building rockets.
And those are all Redstone or Jupiter rockets. One of the two, because it's kind of unclear based on their nose shape. Exactly, yeah. Which rocket that is.
Well, when they were in the manufacturer place, it wasn't, there was no nose to them at that point.
There was one that you could say, well, that either has to be a Redstone, or it is a Jupiter, an early model Jupiter rocket. Regardless, there was some really good stock footage with that, to be honest, because how often do you see a rocket line being shown in general? Like, maybe we didn't they show something similar to that in Destination Moon, but that was like 1950. And that had to have been, no, they didn't show rockets. They just showed the constellations being built and some other manufacturing. But it's rare that you see an actual manufacturing line producing rockets.
And that was probably taken from stock footage of
the
A defense thing.
Yeah, it was probably like Department of Defense thing. The other thing that I thought was really positive in this, and it shocked me, because this movie is bottom of the barrel quality, right? Fair enough, right?
Bottom of the barrel actors.
Yeah, it is. It's Z-list actors, bottom of the barrel production quality. When they go to that Moscow cafe, when I said, there is nothing to state that this is Moscow, up until you get in that cafe and you actually understand a little bit of Russian or Ukrainian culture, there is things in there. And one of them is a samovar. It's kind of a metallic tea urn that you basically warm tea in it.
You warm water.
Yeah, and you warm tea. And the tea cup is on top.
The teapot is on top. And you use a spigot to water down
the super dark tea.
The super dark tea that they cooked on top.
And I'm like, wow, okay, well, that's a nice touch that somebody actually knew about a samovar. And then the balakaya. Yes. Which is Eastern European.
Wasn't playing it right, though.
He wasn't playing it right, but wow, that's very Slav.
Like, and the dance was not
no
Russian dance. It no, was there was more like a Turkish
belly dance kind of thing that was going
on. Yeah, it's more Turkish.
The point was that there was clearly somebody that was
one person. We've come up one person because you also have people speaking Russian.
Oh, I
with no subtitles.
With no subtitles. Well, here's the thing. There are multiple scenes with multiple characters that are speaking Russian. And they're speaking it, as far as I can tell.
For
sure. Yeah, see, Darlene understands only a few words. I understand more than she does. I can't say that I speak it very well. Like, I can understand more than I can speak. And when I speak it, it's more...
Baby.
Yeah, it's more of like I'm a 4-year-old or a 5-year-old. And it's mainly because I don't never get practice. But as far as I could tell, I could follow the discussions they were having. Like, they were talking about how well that this rocket was being, you know, how fast it was being built, but the quality was good. You should thank your workers, blah, 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 blah. There were whole conversations that were in Russian. But if you don't know Russian, this movie's about, what, 71 minutes long? I think that's what it is. I think there's maybe 25 minutes of this movie that is fully in Russian without subtitles and no narration to cover it.
But if it follows any of the discussion that was in United States
it doesn't dialogue, matter.
It didn't matter because all it sounded like was a politician talking nothing and, you know, how they speak and then don't say a thing.
I guess we're kind of backhanded and complimenting the fact that they actually had proper Russian speakers.
Well, I thought that was great.
They had proper Russian speakers. They had proper little Russian pieces of culture in it, like the balaclava and the samovar. There isn't a lot, but
But they also did some bad things too, like the ministers were in a cabinet, you know, in the office with the rest of the cabinet. Well, there's a picture in the window of St. Basil. St. Basil is on the other side of the wall. The Kremlin is a castle.
Well, it's a walled... I don't know, Darlene, because remembering back to when we were in Red Square, I can guarantee that while we were inside St. Basil's and looking out the tiny little slit windows that are in St. Basil's, you can see the top floor of some of the Kremlin buildings.
But not very many of them.
No,
you wouldn't put your cabinet right there.
I don't know. I don't see why.
And where
not.
It was looking from is where the library is.
I don't know. I don't know if I can criticize the movie for that. I honestly
Anyways, don't. It was just trying to tell you that it was Moscow, and the one thing people knew about Moscow
is
St. Basil's Cathedral. But if you've ever stayed in Red Square, you know that you can't see into the Kremlin.
It's difficult. It's difficult, to say the least. I mean, if you go over to the Goom side of Red Square, I think you can see the top. I don't have pictures in front of me,
the
but
the other
I'm going
one
from
was
memory.
The general's.
The general's uniform. Yeah, it was. It didn't look right.
It was plastered with.
Okay, now again, the Soviets love their medals, and we know that from experience doing Soviet World War II reenacting, and that's okay. It's okay to actually have a ton of medals all over you, right? But the way that they were set up wasn't like they were actually on their chest properly. It was just kind of like they were centered
on
his sternum. Like, yeah, it was like, we're going to draw a line straight down from his chin.
You stick certain ones on one side, you stick the other ones on the other. And even if you look at pictures of Soviets today that are from World War II, they will, even if they're not wearing a uniform, they're putting him on one side of their self.
So the one thing we should remark on, though, with how we're kind of discussing this is that our viewpoint is from World War II Soviet reenacting, which is slightly different from 1961 Soviet uniforms. There is a difference, but some of it looks absolutely ridiculous.
That looked ridiculous.
The regular soldiers' uniforms looked fantastic. Like, again, somebody was on the ball somewhere in the production staff of this movie.
But they used American stuff in it.
Yeah, it's but like it didn't, they couldn't. It looked okay. Like,
they did do a night scene too in night.
Okay, so yeah, Darlene, this is another thing we should actually say this movie does right. A lot of these movies from the period, if there is a night scene, it's shot day for night, i.e.,
they're using a filter to put over top of it
to make it look like it's
nighttime because they can't get enough light to actually film things.
They filmed at least a few scenes actually at night, and they didn't do well with it.
No, they didn't.
But credit where credit's due, they tried to film at night. And the thing is, it looks ridiculous because they have to have like spotlights on everybody to illuminate them enough for the camera to film them.
And he's sneaking into the base with that has barbed wire.
This the Western spy. See, I don't even care about his name. Yeah, he's sneaking onto this base past barbed wire, and it looks like there's
white trench coat.
Yeah, it's ridiculous. The only time I actually think it works, the actual night shots, is when the officer at the rocket site sends the soldier off with the bomb, carrying the bomb, and that soldier, yes sir, and runs off that bomb and blows up kind of in the darkness.
Yeah.
I thought that was actually a really well done shot.
But the base was laughable.
The base is concrete, concrete blocks and
with wood. They chopped off wood saplings.
Yeah, and put
barbed wire on it.
And then there's like a ruined brick building nearby. And it's like, what? This is the premier launch site of the Soviet rocket force? Like,
yeah.
No, come on. And then
better stuff out in Siberia.
So is there anything else that you should?
I want to talk about the acting of bad.
Okay, so we're past the point of what this movie actually did well. Because
yes,
as bad as this
using
movie
is. Using Russian.
Yeah.
Using stock footage, that's the best, you know.
Really well done. Yeah, well put together stock footage. And rare, I would say.
And what was the third one?
Little Pieces of Culture.
Little Pieces of Culture. Yeah.
That worked really well. Now, this movie is hot garbage. So we have a lot to talk about of what they did wrong in it.
There was an actor that when he was playing a blind person in Manhattan.
Yeah.
And he's walking, and this is how he said, "Help me."
Yeah, the air raid sirens are going off. He's just kind of tapping down the street, and people are running around him. Like, two people are running around him. And after they're long gone, help me.
It's just like so pathetic.
It's not even pathetic. It's just like,
you didn't even take the time to just go, help me, help me, somebody help me. I can do that, and I'm not an actor.
Yeah, this was help me. Like,
he was sick or something.
Yeah, like he was actually literally just dying. But he's walking around perfectly fine. Yeah, he's blind. there's air raid sirens going on, and you'd think that, hey, I want to talk a little louder because there's air raid sirens going on. There's nobody screaming, right? There's nobody screaming. Everyone's completely calm or ignoring the
or trying to grab a taxi that isn't there.
Oh, taxi, taxi, you know. Right. There's a nuclear warhead coming in. Everyone has been informed of this, and you, sir, are trying to hail goddamn taxi. Get inside the building and take shelter, you piece of crap.
You're in 61, so they would have had
there were air raid shelters.
There was shelters from World War II.
Well, you would have the World War II shelters weren't a big deal in America. I'm saying the air raid shelters for nuclear conflict were around in 1961. They were around
the subway.
Yeah, get in the subway of New York. So, I mean, they're not the best thing of all time. It's not like the Moscow subway that actually was built to survive nuclear war. But, well, it wasn't originally that way, but they put supplies down there in case of it because it's so deep.
And the Red Line.
Yeah. So what else does this movie do wrong, Darlene? Not just the acting, everybody.
Their dialogue is absolutely nonsense.
Yeah. Okay, not only is everyone's acting piss poor, everyone from top to bottom in this movie, all of the dialogue, you're right, is nonsense. It tells you nothing. And then, let's be honest, like I said, about 25 minutes of this movie is dialogue in Russian. And unless you know Russian, there are no subtitles. There's no translation. There are a couple scenes where the narrator basically translates. Basically.
He does not.
He tells you what they're saying, but he's not translating. He's just like, and so-and-so thought this. But most of the scenes are completely untranslated. So it's dialogue that is meaningless because you don't understand it as the regular viewer. Do you think the regular viewer in the United States of this movie in 1961 would understand a lick of Russian?
No.
So what's the point of having all this unless dialogue they were, in Russian? Unless they were Russian.
Russian or a student that was learning Russian.
But that's not what this movie is meant for.
And the fact that they didn't, you'd have to at least send spies that knew Russian.
Why would you send
spies? Or at least one of the languages that are...
I'm baffled by this movie.
Yeah.
I'm baffled by it because it's clear that there is a person involved that cared enough about little details, like the Russian culture stuff, having people that actually spoke Russian, having there are actual Mosin-Nagants in here. There's Soviet weapons that are in this movie. There are uniforms that actually do look authentic for 1961. There's somebody in this thing that actually cared about detail. But yet the dialogue, I just...
Well, first go with the fact that he is the person that wrote this, directed this,
produced it
and narrated it.
He's all the same guy, and he was like the personal pilot for Errol Flynn, and he became like Errol Flynn's manager later on. So there's like one connection that we found between an Errol Flynn movie and one actor from this.
Johnny the Spy.
Okay, there is one actor that went on to actually have a career. There is, and his name is Art Metrano. And he's the truck driver that talks about how his wife is an ugly piece of crap. Like, oh, paint a different woman on your face when I get back and I'll spend my $20 on you.
Oh, my God.
Okay, so this guy is the guy that plays Commandant Mauser in all the Police Academy movies. Well, Mauser.
If you consider that lagging.
Okay, look, the guy had a job. The guy had a job.
Yes, he had a job.
He had a job.
It wasn't like the... We noticed the guy that got into the Errol Flynn one, which was Johnny. He had four movies he was in.
Yeah, but one of them was that Errol Flynn
movie. Errol Flynn movie.
Yeah. So what else did this thing
do
wrong?
And the girl looked like an exploitation.
Yeah, we looked up her on Internet Movie Database. And it looks like, yeah, it was all sexploitation type films from the 60s, which means they're just going to be really skeevy and not really show. They're not going to show any real nudity unless they're a grindhouse film. And even then, that's, oh, come on. And, you know, are there any actors or actresses that stand out in this at all?
Like I said, the actor that stood out to me was the help me.
Because it was so bad. I don't know. Folks, this movie is just baffling.
Well, you did say it was one of the worst films.
Yeah, like people really think this is an awful film. And to be honest,
it is.
It is terrible because it's not really a movie. It's a propaganda piece that does not have a plot. It has an idea that could have been told in 10 minutes. And, oh my God, like, the thing that makes it a movie, and I'm gonna go out on a limb here, and I'm gonna shock you. I recommend watching this film.
I don't.
I know, but let me explain. Let me explain why. Why do you think I would recommend this film, Darlene?
Somebody to know what not to do.
No, it's not just that. It's not just that. Not just to learn what not to do. It's the fact that something so incompetent and so poorly made still has a fraction of passion in it somewhere from someone to do one thing
that
right.
That poor person probably got berated 20,000 times as they were doing this.
Just the idea of going, I want to have people that are speaking Russian in this because it's authentic. That is a bold move. The fact is that the producer, writer, director, whoever, decided not to dub them or subtitle it. And it made it so these scenes, which could have been very interesting, like we actually got native Russian speakers and they're having these whole scenes of dialogue. It could have made them into actual, they could have been characters. I'm not saying that they would have been because this movie is so poorly written that the point is that they had the possibility of being actual characters and not just caricature villains. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
There is an idea in this movie that one person had, and I guarantee you it wasn't the producer, writer, director.
Narrator.
All the same guy. It wasn't that person that had this idea. It couldn't have been.
No, or they would have put subtitles because they knew how to speak Russian. Because they're the ones that probably taught the person Russian.
No, I think those were actually Russian immigrants.
You think those were Russian immigrants?
I think those were Soviet immigrants of the time. Either from like Ukraine, Russia,
or maybe
Belarus.
they put their stuff into the thing.
So when any native Russian speakers listen to this review, I would suggest, hey, go and listen to this movie
and tell us if it's really competent.
Russian. Yeah. Tell us if these scenes actually are saying anything properly. Because I mean, like I said, I can kind of follow most of what they're saying. Because it's usually very simple words. But the fact is that I'm probably not getting the subtext of it. Mm-hmm. But what I'm trying to say is listen for the accents and tell me if these people are from Belarus, the Baltics, you know, Russia, Ukraine. They could be from anywhere. But the point is, I am sure they have to be immigrants to the U.S. that are native speakers because they didn't sound like Americans speaking Russian. It sounded like they were very confident with what they were saying to each other.
Well, anyway, yeah. On that.
I'm
the other name that it went by is 5 Minutes to Zero.
Which, I don't know, would that be a better title? I mean, what does it matter? What does it matter with this
Rocket film? Attack USA?
What does it matter?
It doesn't, but I just thought that to tell the people that there was another name for it.
Yeah. So you can watch this as an MST3K. I'm glad I watched the regular version of it because I did get to pick out some other things that
might have been undone.
That might have been joked over. And I really love that MST3K. That's a really good episode of MST3K. But I'm glad I watched the regular version. Now, I don't know where to find it. We had it in a box set from Mill Creek. Is it Sci-Fi Invasion or was it? I think it's their Sci-Fi Invasion box set of 50 movies that we had it. It could be available on YouTube. It could be on Amazon Prime. I couldn't tell you.
Yeah, Sci-Fi Invasion.
It's Sci-Fi Invasion, and it's from Mill Creek. So regardless, I recommend watching it just because this movie is beyond baffling to me of what it was trying to do besides being propaganda.
It was propaganda.
But it was bad propaganda because it made all these assumptions about, like, well, the Soviet Air Force can 100% kill every American bomber. And how is this not the end at the end? Like, don't let this be the end. No, it is, because you just attacked New York City. And are you thinking that the U.S. Army isn't going to use Davy Crockett's and tactical nuclear weapons in Eastern Europe?
All the way to Moscow?
All the way to Moscow. Because it's the end of the world. This, it's done. What are you trying to say?
And we would have had the B-52s that are still flying.
Well, they even show a B-52 in this.
Yes, but you would have had that...
Strategic Air Command, Operation Chrome Dome.
Chrome Dome was going on.
And Operation Chrome Dome is the
polar patrols.
The polar patrols of B-52s that were always loaded with nuclear weapons flying around the Arctic Circle waiting for the call to go in and bomb the hell out of the Soviets.
And we got rid of SAC in 1992.
Was it 92?
I was just getting out
of the Air Force
at that time. Yeah.
See, Darlene served in the Air Force.
And I was a SAC person.
Yeah, she actually served in SAC.
And I served in two different commands, and I'll tell you, SAC was ready. They would put you through the ringer on their doggone
checklists and procedures and everything.
Not just the what made them ready was they would do scenarios where you were in this wartime and you were supposed to get this done
in this amount of time.
Otherwise, in this amount of time, or you fail.
Yeah.
And if you failed, oh God, you were going to be doing exercises
and practicing to not
fail that. Over in Spain and we do chemical warfare training, and I'd fail every damn time because I hyperventilate in a gas mask. And they didn't redo them on me.
Because you panicked in a gas mask.
Yep, I panic in a gas mask.
Well, oh well. SAC's gone now, unfortunately. SAC was good.
SAC was good for us. It made us ready.
So at the very least, folks, I recommend it. Darlene doesn't. Make up your own mind. Watch the MST3K version of it, at the very least, if you can find it. I think it's worth it. I think it's worth watching just to try to understand why. Why was this made?
Yeah.
So that's it for us. We were talking about Rocket Attack USA.
A.K.A.
what, 5 minutes to zero?
5 minutes to zero.
And that's from 1961, and it's a POS... Cold War propaganda film about a nuclear attack on the United States.
With great stock footage.
With really good stock footage and good
use of it.
Good cultural stuff, too.
And good use of stock footage.
And good use of stock footage.
So I will say good night.
Yep. Have a nice time, guys. We'll see you in the next episode. Bye.
At no point in your rambling, incoherent response were you even close to anything that could be considered a rational thought.
Thanks for listening to this episode of This Week in Geek. Hungry for more? Check out our website at thisweekingeek.net. You can subscribe to the podcast, browse our Twitter and Instagram, and leave your thoughts on today's topics. If you'd like to give us some feedback, send us an email at feedback@thisweekingeek.net. Tune in next time, and remember,
lower your shields and surrender your listenership.
We would be honored if you would join us.
Thank you for your cooperation. Good night.